Well, Pastor Wayne, we welcome everybody to Holy Thursday service as we're heading into Good Friday and Resurrection Sunday, an exciting day.
Amen.
Celebrating our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Glory to God.
Amen.
It's a special week, special time to celebrate the Lord and all that He's done.
Amen.
For this week, we do take our minds off of ourselves and we put it on Him.
Yes.
Because He did an extraordinary thing that was really no other way to solve the problem. And to think that He would come to save ourselves, save ourselves from our sin. And He was able to do it.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
To God be the glory.
Glory.
Amen.
So we pray over this offering tonight. Mm-hmm. Lord, we thank You for Your anointing upon this time of hearing Your word. Our eyes and our ears and our being is open to have You plant the Word of God in each one of our lives. And we thank You, Father, it is our desire to also bless You back with an offering to this ministry to help us to preach the Word around the world.
Amen.
People need God. And there's no better way than to preach it, the Word of God, to them. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Praise God.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Wayne. All right, so tonight the message, Jesus, the Lamb of God. What we're going to do, we're going to search the scriptures and we're going to examine the fact that Jesus is the Lamb of God. We're going to answer the question, why would Jesus lay down His very life for sinful mankind? And then, after the examination, we're going to ask ourselves this major question. Would we ever forsake our Lord? Would we? Okay, so let's just dig right in. Let's go over to John chapter 1. We're going to read verse 29. John 1, 29. The next day, John saw Jesus coming towards him, and he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." Now think about this. When we fully realize the finished work of Christ as the Lamb of God, where are we? Where are we in that revelation? Where are we in our daily walk when things happen and we're maybe faced with a situation, a trial, a test? Where are we? Are we understanding that Jesus Christ is the Lamb of God? When will we fully understand it? Where will we be? We're going to be at the great white throne of judgment. It's at that time those who have rejected Jesus Christ as the personal Lord and Savior will be separated into the lake of fire. But for the Christian, for the child of God who's accepted, you've accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, don't fear, all right? You stay abiding in the vine. He abides in us. You don't have to fear that you're not going to be in Him, with Him eternally, all right? The key, though, is our own free will. As we determine in our hearts to stay connected, abiding in the vine, we don't have to fear eternal damnation. So as the Christian, we inhabit the new heaven and then truly understand at that point the sacrificial work of Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. All right, what do we see right now? As we search the scriptures, all right, as we're like the Bereans, we study the word daily. As we search the scriptures, we see our Lord and Savior, the sinless lamb, the lamb without stain, the lamb without blemish. He knew no sin. The lamb without bitterness, no guile found in His mouth. You know, our heart is to be like our Lord. But think about that. We know the word tells us the righteous man sins 7 times daily. But when we do, we're going to miss it. What do? We sit and wallow in that condemnation? No. We confess the sin, and the word says we're washed white as snow, all right? Jesus doesn't remember it as far as the east is from the west. God the Father doesn't remember it as far as the east is from the west. We have to keep that in our heart, but the key is repent and tell God you're sorry that you missed the mark in sin. But one of the things is we see the Lamb without bitterness, no guile in His mouth. That's where it's so important for us to really say, Father, may my words be edifying. May the words that I speak build people up, not tear them down. May the words I speak be Your word, Your promises, and then You promise to watch over the words we speak and bring Your word to pass in each of our lives. In Exodus 12:5, it says, "The lamb shall be without blemish, a male, In 2 Corinthians 5:21, he who made him, who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we might be the righteousness of God in Christ. So when we accept him, what happens? We stand righteous in right doing. We have to keep pursuing holiness. But upon that confession of Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, you stand as the righteousness of God in Christ. And you now have the indwelling Holy Spirit to help you continue living that holy life. Then we look at our Lord and Savior, the separated Lamb. The separated Lamb, sanctified by and through the Father, separated from the fallen. We see that in the Word, Exodus 12:5. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats, Hebrews 7:26. For such a high priest was fitting for us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and has become higher than the heavens. What are we talking about? We're talking about the separated Lamb. We look at our Lord and Savior, the substituted Lamb. The substituted Lamb. He took our sin. He took our sorrow. He took disease. He tasted death for us, and he triumphed over Satan. What that means is when the enemy tries to come against our lives and put sickness, disease, malfunctions, try to attach them to us, what do we see here? Jesus, the substituted Lamb, he took the price so we don't have to bear those sicknesses, diseases, malfunctions. He took them on himself that we might walk in the covenant of divine health, spirit, mind, and body. Hebrews 9:12, not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood, he entered the most holy place once and for all and obtained eternal redemption. You know that saying? It doesn't mean that you're going to be healthy for like 5 years out of your life, but then sickness is going to come upon you. Or, you know, you got healed, but you need to be fearful that those symptoms may come back. No, what does it say here? Eternal redemption. Jesus Christ, eternal redemption. Sozo life that we obtain. Sozo, the God kind of life. So when you receive a healing, you just stand on the promises. Nahum 1:9, those symptoms cannot come back on my body again. I am the healed of the Lord. God heals me, and it's an eternal promise. What the devil's going to try to do, he tries to come back and serve you those same lying symptoms. You need to say, no, I don't receive them. I received healing in that area. And then really just keep filling yourself up. I'm standing on the area of healing, but you can apply this to the area of finances, to peace, to joy, every covenant blessing that the enemy would try to keep coming and stealing from us. We have to fight that good fight of faith and say no to the enemy when he's tried to serve or reserve lies of the enemy. Our Lord and Savior, then we see the slain Lamb, Jesus Christ, slain from the foundation of the world. He shed his precious blood to redeem us from sin and eternal damnation. We see that in Exodus 12:6. Now you shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month. Then the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it at twilight. We see it in Revelation 13:8. All who dwell on earth will worship him, whose names have not been written in the book of life, slain from the foundation of the world. All who dwell on the earth will worship him. All right? It's going to come to a point where every knee is going to bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. So why not do it tonight? Why not do it today? Today is the day of salvation. If there's going to come a point where your knee's going to bow anyway, stop fighting God. Stop questioning. Is he real? You know, give me proof. That's what about Thomas, the Thomas kind of faith? And what did he do? Finally, he realized, this is the Savior. This is my Lord. And he just said, God, it's almost like, forgive me for not believing. You may be watching tonight and you have questions in your mind, or maybe you're not a Christian. Maybe you're following a false religion. Remember, Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, the life. And serving false gods, your knee is not going to bow to Allah. Your knee is not going to bow to Muhammad. All right? Your knee is going to bow to Jesus Christ, the Lord and Savior, who redeemed us from Satan's kingdom and translated us into the kingdom of God. Make the decision tonight. We look at our Lord and Savior, the sacrificed lamb. He made atonement for sinful man, magnified righteousness with the written word of God. Think about that. Magnified righteousness, magnified right doing with the written word of God. Every time you open your Bible, God is speaking to you. What is he speaking? He's speaking right doing. All right, we want to throw the Bible out. It's the only standard that's going to bring peace to this world. It's the only standard that's going to reestablish the end of lawlessness that we're seeing everywhere. What? It's the written word of God that brings peace to the family, brings peace to your heart and mind. Huh? Magnified righteousness with the written word. Every time we open up that written word and we read it and we speak it and we meditate on it, what we're doing is we're magnifying righteousness. We're magnifying the perfect will of God in and through our lives. Why? Because Jesus is the sacrificed Lamb of God. We see that in 1 Corinthians 5:7. Therefore, purge out the old leaven, that you may be a new lump, since you truly are unleavened, for indeed Christ, our Passover, was sacrificed for us. Our Lord and Savior, he's also the sufficient Lamb. Sufficient, what does that mean? He's not just enough, he's more than enough. He met and satisfied God's demand for righteousness. God demanded righteousness. We could never fulfill it. We could never live up to the standard of the law. But what did Jesus do? He said, I came to fulfill the law, to write it on your heart. And when you love the Lord God with all your heart and all your mind, all your being, and you love your neighbor as yourself, you fulfill the Ten Commandments. You fulfill the law. How? By the power of the Holy Spirit. One example, let's say you're at odds with an individual, all right? And you really just can't stand that person. Well, what does the word say? Bless those who persecute you. And as you do it, what are you doing? You're fulfilling the word of God. Can you do it in your own strength? No. The people that I talk to and minister to many times, I had one individual say to me, I just wish they just dropped dead. My life would be a lot easier. Well, my gosh, what you sow, you're going to reap. You don't pray prayers like that and speak things like that. What you do is you bless them. What is the old saying? Hurting people hurt people. Sometimes people are so rotten and mean because deep down inside they're hurting. And your prayers for that kind of a person, you may be the only one that's praying to redeem them from that lifestyle, to redeem them from that madness, right? The madman of Gadara, what did Jesus do? He cast the devil out of them. Well, see, Pastor Marian, that's what it is. They're just possessed. That's why they work and operate that way. No, all right? Well, there's very few people that are actually possessed. They may be oppressed, and that oppression may allow them to act the way they act. But your love, that man of Gadara, when he was healed, when Jesus cast the demons out of him, what did Jesus do? He hugged him. He welcomed him into the family of God, right? Your love may be bringing someone in, someone that you can't even stand dealing with. Your love and being the living epistle, just praying for them and loving them, even sometimes from that distance, or your prayers of intercession could be the very thing that's going to bring them to confess Jesus Christ as personal Lord and Savior before the end time when they have to bow their knee. All right? Our sufficient Lamb. He met and sacrificed God's demand for righteousness, the mediator between God and man. We can't make it to God on our own, all right? What does the word say? Jesus Christ is the door. He stands at the door of every person's heart and he knocks. He's not gonna open by it, you know, and just say, well, let me in. I'm gonna push this door down. No, he knocks. And it's up to us to exercise our will to open the door and invite him in. And what ends up happening? When we do, it reestablishes that road, that bridge between us and God the Father. We can't just go to God the Father. Jesus is the mediator. That's why we need to confess Jesus Christ as a personal Lord and Savior. He is that bridge. He makes the way for us to establish relationship between us and Father God. We see it in Hebrews 10:12. But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for the sins forever, sat down at the right hand of God. And then we see our Lord and Savior, the saving Lamb. The saving Lamb, abounding in love, abounding in grace, abounding in mercy, abounding in power, abolished the penalty of sin and death. He just doesn't have love. He just doesn't have grace. He just doesn't have mercy. He just doesn't have power. Our Lord and Savior is love. He is grace. He is mercy. He is power. Now think about that. When we're in Christ, when we've accepted Jesus as our personal Lord and Savior, and we're in Christ and He's abiding in us, what happens to us? We then become love. God in us. God in us. He is love. And what happens is we open ourselves up, and it's like a river of love flows out. Why do you think people are attracted to you? It's not your good looks. It's not the way you dress. It's not how much money you have, though that's how the world operates. The fact with a child of God, you draw men unto you because of the anointing, the Holy Spirit on the inside of you. When they look at you, they go, there's something different about you. What is it about you? You could be the ugliest person on planet Earth, but when you are saved and filled with the glory of God, you become an incredibly beautiful person. You know, there's somebody maybe watching tonight, and you look in the mirror and you go like, I really, look at me. Look, I'm getting old. Look how I look. Maybe you're young and you just look in the mirror and you go like, I'm not attractive. Yes, you are. You have God in you, the love of God, the power of God, the glory of God. And when people see you, they see the manifestation of the love, the grace, the mercy, and the power. So don't ever put yourself down. You lift your eyes up, you throw your head back and just say, you know what? God is in me. He created me. He gave me this body for a reason. Now, if you've done stuff to make it, you know, fat, ugly, whatever, then stop doing what you're doing and do the best you can. Be a good steward of this body. And when you are doing that, all you will do is exemplify the love of God, the glory of God, the mercy of God, the power of God. He abolished the penalty of sin and death as well, Hebrews 7:25. Therefore, he is also able to save to the uttermost those who come to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. He's making intercession for you, Jesus Christ, our Lord, sitting at the right hand of the Father. He's making intercession for you. All right, praise God. We have an incredible prayer team, and we intercede for people that send prayer requests in. But as we pray, they ascend to the throne of God, Jesus, our Lord and Savior, then turns to the Father and says, you hear that prayer that just came up? You hear that prayer request? He's interceding to the Father. And the Father looks, because of you, Jesus, because you paid the penalty for sin, because you paid the penalty that by the your stripes, they'd walk in the fullness of divine health covenant. Granted. The request is granted. What an incredible gift we have to have Jesus Christ at the right hand of the Father as our intercessor. Now think about this. Was it easy for the Lord? All right, we just celebrated Palm Sunday, today Holy Thursday, tomorrow Good Friday. I really encourage you tomorrow, take time to really, at least an hour, or maybe more through the day, and just thank the Lord, worship the Lord. Fast a meal, fast TV, fast your phone. Turn your phone off for a day, and really just meditate on the fact that Jesus, on that Good Friday, what did he do? He sacrificed his very life that we may have that sozo life, the God kind of life. So was it easy for him? No. He was forsaken by his own Father. 2 Corinthians 5:21, for he, the Father, made him to know no sin, to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. His own Father had to turn away from him. He was forsaken by his own race of people. John 1:11, he came to his own, and his own did not receive him. You know, you may have received the Lord, and your family thinks you're some crazy nut, all right? Oh, they became one of them Looney Tunes. They become one of them religious fanatics, all right? I don't want any part of them anymore. Everything you're hearing, it's always about Jesus. Oh, thank God. Oh, praise God. I don't want to hear that. You know, that's your Jesus. Keep your Jesus to yourself. What ends up happening? Some of your very family turns away from you. Some of the friends that you have, they don't want to be around you anymore because you don't do the things that you used to do. You don't live the way you used to live. Oh, you became that religious freak. You can't even enjoy life anymore. No, we're filled with the joy of the Lord. We have the new wine. Huh? We don't have to drink wine and alcohol and get drunk to have a good time. No, we're so filled with the joy of the Lord, with the new wine, the Holy Ghost, that people look at you and say, how come you're always happy? Look what you're going through in life. How could you be happy in the hour that you're in? Everything falling apart in this world system, and you're not worried, you're not fearful. No, because I'm in covenant with a covenant-keeping God. My God is alive. My God's sitting at the right hand of the Father. I have the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. And if God be for me, who or what can be against me? Therefore, I don't fear. I don't fear. I'm in God's hands. And before this is all over, He's taking us out of here anyway. And we have eternal life, an eternal kingdom that's on the horizon. All right, so forsaken by His own race, don't let it bother you. You just be that light, be that example, and just enjoy your life in Christ. He was forsaken by His own disciples, all right? Not only His family, His friends, but His own disciples who walked with Him and talked with Him for the 3.5 years that they ministered together. John 6:6. For that time, many of His disciples went back and walked with Him no more. Now, I thought that was really interesting when I read those verses. John 6:66. What is the mark of the Antichrist? 666. Now, think about that. At that time, many of His disciples went back and walked with Him no more. Is that what's happening today? How many Christians are falling by the wayside? The Word even told us there'd be a great falling away. What? From the Word, from faith. And what are these people doing? They're turning to the world. They're trusting in the world. And what are they going to end up with? The mark of the beast, 666. And right here, John 6:66, many of His disciples went back. Not the world went back, His disciples, those that walked with Him and talked with Him and cast out devils and preached the gospel, turned away from our Lord and Savior. Yet He kept His focus on the cross for the sake of the love He had for every one of us. Forsaken by His own family, Psalm 69:8, I have become a stranger to my brothers and an alien to my mother's children. Right here again. And John 7:5, for even His brothers did not believe Him. Then He was forsaken by His own followers. Forget the disciples. Now even those that followed Him. How many people came? Huh? He fed the multitude. How many times? Where were they when He went to the cross? Huh? Doesn't that show you something? How many people are in churches? We know people that have actually told us, I only go to church because I'm trying to find a husband. I'm trying to find a wife. I want a good Christian man or a good Christian woman. We have MOs in the body of Christ. Huh? What happens here? Where'd all those followers go at the very end? Were they on their face? Were they, Jesus went to the Garden of Gethsemane. Something must be going on. Did you hear the news? Let me tell you something. Word traveled. Where were all those people? They turned their back on the one that fed them. Jesus, the Word, feeds us every day, His holy Word. And we turn our back on Him? Mark 3:21, but when His own people heard about this, His own people heard about this, they went out to lay hold of Him and they said, He's out of His mind. He's out of His mind. All right, so meditating on all of this, here's the question I ask myself. Now, if I'm asking myself this question, my prayer is that you'll ask yourself this question. Would I forsake my Lord? Would I forsake my Lord? And what would my response be? You know, it's one thing to say, no, I'm standing on the Word of God. I'm standing on every promise. I'm a child of God. Well, what happens when they come knocking at your door and they say, we want your Bible? And if you don't denounce Jesus, you're going to be beheaded. How many of these martyrs have we seen already? What decision would you make? Huh? Well, no, it's okay. I'm not really one of them. Isn't that what Peter did? I don't know him. What would we do? What would you do? You got to really think about that. You see, it's easy for us to respond, Lord, I would never leave you or forsake you. That was Peter's response. Let's just look at it in the Word. Matthew 26, verses 33 to 35. I'm going to read it from the Amplified. Peter replied to him, "Though they all fall away because of you and doubt and disown you, I will never fall away." That was Peter's confession to the Lord. And Jesus said to him, "I assure you and most solemnly say to you, this night before the rooster crows, you will completely deny me three times." Peter said to Jesus, "Even if I have to die with you, I will not deny you." And all the disciples said the same thing. You know, we kind of skip over that verse. They're standing there and they're listening to Peter say this. And what do they say? "Yes, we're with you, Jesus. Yes, we agree. Whatever Peter said, we just said." What does it say in the word? "And all the disciples said the same thing. Even if I die with you, I will never deny you." Huh? Where were they? Where were they? We know where they all went because Jesus' words came to pass. You go to the Garden of Gethsemane and the disciples enter in. Matthew 26, verses 36 to 41. "Then Jesus came to the place called Gethsemane, Olive Press, and he told his disciples, 'Sit here while I go pray.' And taking with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, James and John, he began to be grieved and greatly distressed. Then he said to them, 'My soul is deeply grieved, so that I am almost dying of sorrow. Stay here and stay awake and keep watch with me.'" Now think about that. They are there, Peter, James, and John. They begin to be grieved. They see Jesus begin to be grieved and distressed. Now, if you have a good, good friend, and you see them going through stuff, what would you do? What's going on? How can I pray for you? What can I do to help you? All right, just give me like 5 minutes. I want to take a nap before I do that. Isn't that what they did? We're here. We're going to even die with you, Jesus, but we can't even stay awake for an hour. So what does he say? Stay here. Jesus says, stay here and stay awake with me. Keep watch with me. And after going a little farther, he fell down on his face and he prayed, saying, "My Father, if it's possible, that is consistent with your will, let this cup pass from me, yet not as I will, but as you will." You know, we think like, oh, Jesus, yeah, he just said yes to the will of the Father, and he went to the garden, and he died on the cross, and he rose again. He knew he was going to rise again, so no big deal. No. He says to the Father, "If it's possible, consistent with your will." What was God's will? "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son." He asked Jesus, "Will you do this for humanity? Will you do this as I'm asking you?" And what did Jesus say? "Yes to the will of the Father." How many times God asks us to do something and it's like, "Oh yeah, I'm going to do that, Lord. I'm going to do this. I'm going to say this. I'm going to minister. I'm going to do this and that. Everything according to your word." And what do? We forget. But we don't want to do it. But we feel like, "I'll do it another time or another day." He says, "No, my will is to do the will of the Father. Now, if it's possible that it's consistent with your will, let the cup pass from me, but not as I will, Father, but as you will." And he came to the disciples and he what? Found them interceding and on their face and crying out and, "Oh God, help our Savior." No, what did he find them doing? Sleeping. Found them sleeping and said to Peter, "So you mean you could not stay awake and keep watch with me for 1 hour? Keep actively watching and praying that you may not come into temptation? The spirit is willing, but the body is weak." Now think about that. The spirit is willing and the body is weak. We don't have that excuse today because we have the Holy Spirit living on the inside of us who enables us to fulfill the will of the Father. So again, I ask myself the question, would I forsake the Lord? Would I forsake the Lord? Think about it. What's your response? Would you forsake the Lord? The word tells us in these last days, prior to the return of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, this great falling away, we are seeing it. And these are just the birth pangs of what's taking place, the birth pangs of what Matthew speaks of, the words of Jesus when he prophesied what was going to take place. We're seeing the birth pangs of the great falling away from faith, the word of God. Another question, why would Jesus lay down his very life for sinful mankind? Why? He did it all for love, all for love. You know, if you didn't listen to the offering song before the service, I really encourage you, go back, click it, and go and listen to that word and let it minister to you. All for love. He did it in obedience to the will of the Father, John 3:16. Therefore, he's also able to save to the uttermost those who come to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. He did it in obedience. He did it in love. The love for humanity, the love for you. You may feel, there's nobody that loves me. I'm alone in life. I have nobody. That's a lie of the enemy. Because you have Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior, who paid the price, as we've seen through every one of these aspects here tonight. He will never leave you. He will never forsake you. He upholds you with his victorious right hand. And though your family may turn on you, may desert you, your friends, your family, you are never alone. You have God. You have Jesus. You have the Holy Ghost. And when you press into him, you don't even notice those things. See, when you are focused on that stuff, it shows one thing. You're focused more on the natural than you are the spiritual. We need to really meditate on everything we've heard tonight and head as we head towards the celebration. It is a celebration of the Resurrection Day, Resurrection Sunday. Determine in our hearts. Make that decision here tonight. In your heart, in your mind, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, you will never turn away from your Lord. You will never turn away, never fall away. You make that decision tonight. Father, on this Holy Thursday, I truly acknowledge you as my Lord and Savior. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, the indwelling Holy Spirit in me, I'm pressing ahead. I'm pressing towards the high calling of God. I'm not looking back. I'm not looking to the left. I'm not looking to the right. I'm keeping my focus on the captain of the host, Jesus Christ. And no matter what winds are blowing, what storms are raging, I know in whom I have believed and I continue to believe. And I am here on planet Earth to fulfill the great commission of the go ye in Mark 16:17-18. By the power of the Holy Ghost, I will fulfill the call of God on my life before physical life on this earth ends for me. A commission to tell the world about his love and the finished work at Calvary. That's what it's all about. Glory to God. Pastor Wayne.
Boy, that a lot of times you talk about the redemption, and we talk about what Jesus did, and we don't talk about what they did to him. Mm-hmm. While he's trying to pay the price.
Amen. Yes.
For our freedom. He didn't get any support from mankind.
No.
He had to totally trust in the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
He had to totally trust in his Heavenly Father.
Yes.
That he sent him here. And if he sent him here to do this job, then he would have to bring him back.
Amen.
And much like Isaac, when he was on the altar and Abraham was going to sacrifice him, Isaac didn't jump up from the altar and say, you know, you crazy old man, just leave me alone. I don't want nothing to do with you.
Mm-hmm.
He laid there, and like Abraham, and again, many people don't think about this from Isaac's standpoint, but Isaac had to lay there and say, okay, if I'm the only seed and he kills me, then God has to bring me back. So that's what was going on. It was an incredible amount of stress on a person to go through this. And many times you can think about your own life, how much stress you go through, things that are happening in your life, and you're wondering, why is this? Why is this, Lord? Why, mm-hmm. why? Well, it probably comes down to a walk of faith.
Amen.
Jesus could only do this because he actually believed he was the Son of God. He had to fulfill this calling that
Amen.
God had called him to be. He had to believe that God would raise him from the dead. He
Amen.
Told his disciples beforehand, I'm going to kill me, I'm going to go to hell, I'm going to be raised back to life again 3 days later.
Amen.
Just like Jonah came out of the whale, I'm going to come back to life.
Mm-hmm.
It sounds too far-fetched to believe, because natural things don't operate that way. But spiritual mm-hmm. things do. And so this is a very good teaching, because what it does is shows us sometimes when we are children of God, we have to do things, and we have to do it not really by ourselves, but it seems like we have to do it by ourselves. because it's only God, the Holy Spirit, and our faith in God that enables us to accomplish what we're going to do. And I say,
amen.
Praise the Lord when we learn those lessons, each one of us.
Amen. And, you know, think about it. As I'm listening to you, the picture that I have come to my mind is if Jesus had allowed any doubt or fear, it could have aborted the whole plan.
Everything.
And you could say, well, he would not have done that. He was God. He was the God-man.
Yes.
And it even says in the Word, everything that we're tempted with, he was tested in those same areas.
Yeah.
Tested in areas, we're tested in areas. And the fact of the matter is, he did not doubt, he did not fear, and he didn't even have the Holy Ghost on the inside of us.
Right.
All right? So we really have no excuse, and we have such a gift when he said, on the day of Pentecost, tarry in Jerusalem until you receive the gift of the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
He has not left us comfortless. He's left us with every good and perfect gift. So if you're watching tonight and you've
never
made that decision to accept Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, tonight is your night.
Yes.
We're going to say that prayer together.
Yes.
We're going to just stand in agreement that this is going to be the greatest Easter gift, Resurrection Sunday gift you could ever have imagined. And if you're watching and you kind of fell away and just not so on fire for God anymore, we're going to also pray for the fire to be rekindled and just be everything God's called you to be with the joy of the Lord.
Yes.
So, Father, we just stand in agreement. We make this profession of faith. Father God.
Father God.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
The name above all names.
The name above all names.
The one who is the sacrificial lamb.
The one who is the sacrificial lamb.
The Lamb of God.
The Lamb of God.
Who's knocking at the door of my heart.
Knocking at the door of my
heart. I'm opening the door tonight.
I'm opening the door tonight.
And I say, come in, Lord Jesus.
Come in, Lord Jesus.
I confess with my mouth.
I confess with my mouth.
I believe in my heart.
I believe in my heart.
That you are Lord.
That you are Lord.
And the rest of my days here on the earth.
The rest of my days here on this earth.
I commit to you.
I commit to
you. I submit to your word.
I submit to your word.
And to fulfill your plan.
To fulfill your plan.
And purpose for my life.
And purpose for my life.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
I proclaim.
I proclaim.
I am now.
I am now.
Born again.
Born again.
Child of the living God.
Living by the living God.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
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 Praise the Lord.
And for those that kind of like went by the wayside and you just feel like I've lost that zeal, I've lost that fire. Just put your hand right on your heart right now. So, Father, there's no distance in prayer. Right. Pastor Wayne and I stand in agreement.
Yes, we do.
An igniting of the fire of
Hallelujah.
God.
Hallelujah.
An igniting of the fire of God. Such
Glory.
A zeal, such a desire
Glory.
To do all that God's called you to do. Open doors for them, Lord, that no man can open.
Amen.
Open opportunities for them to be that witness, that living epistle, and go to places that you ordained.
Yes.
The steps of the righteous are ordered of the Lord. Order their steps that they could fulfill each and every day with the zeal, with the fire
praise
of God.
Praise you, Lord.
We give you all the praise, all the glory.
Yes,
we
Lord.
Give you thanks in advance, Father, for what you're doing here. We pray, Father God, for those that may be fighting symptoms in their body, fighting symptoms in their finances, whatever the area is, Lord.
In the name of Jesus.
You have already paid the price, the healing fire, the fire of God in their bodies, in their minds, in their organs, their tissues, their muscles, their cells, in their finances. We speak life to their finances.
Yes,
they come alive. Name. You make a way where there seems to be no way. We thank you for jobs, people standing in agreement for jobs.
Yes,
open
Lord.
Up a supernatural door.
Yes.
We thank you for promotions on jobs.
Yes, Lord.
There may be many people that are ahead of you on a line of promotion, but no, you are the cream of the crop.
Yes.
You're in covenant with a covenant-keeping God.
Yes, Lord.
And you are rising up that the person that hires or fires in that company, you are before their eyes and they see you as the cream of the crop needed for that company. And a blessing to that
yes,
company,
Lord.
Whether they're saved or not,
yes,
with
Lord.
Advancement and financial increase. We thank you, Father. We thank you for people believing for houses.
Thank you, Lord.
Make a way where there seems to be
yes,
no way. We don't
Jesus
care what
name.
The mortgage rates are. We don't care what anything says in the natural. You're the God of sufficiency. You're the God that makes a way where there seems to be no way. We thank you for manifestation, for a house, apartments,
Glory.
Whatever they're believing God for. You
yes,
are not
Lord.
A respecter of people.
Yes, Lord.
You will open up the door for this blessing in their lives.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you for restoration in families. people that are standing in agreement and believing for their sons, their daughters, their in-laws to come to Christ. We thank you, Father. There's angels on assignment. They're going to be bombarded from the north, south, east, and west with people that are Christians, not pushy Christians, but those that are exemplifying the love of God and touching their hearts. We call their salvations in, Father, this Easter week, this Easter day, Resurrection Sunday. Bring these people in their path. We call them saved,
in Jesus'
sanctified,
name.
Redeemed, and serving the Lord, in the name of Jesus. Father, for every other area where people are standing and just standing in faith, believing you for, meet the need. Jesus, you are the intercessors. We're sending these prayers up now. You're receiving them. You're turning to
praise
the Father,
God.
And the
praise
Father's
the
looking and saying, I call it done.
Yes, Lord.
In the name above all names, my Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord, Pastor Wayne.
Boy, this was good. It was a good service because it really helps us to see them more of both sides of the perspective of what the Lord has done.
Amen.
This is all God's Holy Week. This is why the focus is totally on the Lord and what He did for us. He is wonderful. He absolutely is wonderful what
Thank
He has
you,
done
Lord.
For us. Never forget that. Praise Him all the time. Praise Him in the morning. Praise Him in the evening. Praise Him at supper time. Praise Him every time. And excuse me, anytime. You can praise the Lord and give Him glory,
Thank you, Lord.
Honor, and praise.
Jesus.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. Praise God.
We will see you on
Resurrection Sunday.
Resurrection Sunday.
Thank you,
in
Lord.
In Jesus' name.
God bless you.
Love you.